Welcome to On the Radar, our weekly weather chat where we chat about all things weather. Now, this week we're talking about how to keep your pets calm during storms and how to best manage your animals during a natural disaster. So stay tuned. So when we flagged that we were going to be talking about animals and the weather, the most common response we got was talking about how all of your dogs in particular were scared of storms. Now, with all the storms going on at the moment, I did a little digging and I'm no vet, but we wanted to look into how we could help out the little feathers during the storm. So if you just bear with me while I share my screen. So this article was put together by my colleagues up in North Queensland, where they get a lot of storms. Now, according to this, there are a few things that you can do to calm your dog in a storm. Now, the first is to put them in a storm jacket, which works by providing constant and mild pressure to the dog's body. Another one can be to train your pet to consider a crate a safe space where they can safely hide out during a storm. But you need to be careful there because, of course, according to Bruce Howlett, the vet consulted in this piece, he urges against confining an animal that is really scared because they can really hurt themselves when they're trying to escape. Another thing that you can do is to try and keep your dog mentally stimulated so that they have less energy to be anxious. And if you do have a pet that is really scared, you can also help them out by getting some medication. So if you speak to your vet, they should be able to help you. In the meantime, we do have the link available to that article if you'd like some more information. So still today on the theme of pets and storms and disasters, I reached out to Mel Taylor, Honorary Associate Professor at Macquarie University and consultant at Enduring Advantage Consulting. Now, Mel has just finished up a 3-year project working with the Natural Hazards CRC, looking into the best practice in animal emergency management. Now, here's what she had to say. So Mel, thank you so much for joining us today.
You're welcome. It's great to be here.
We're here because you've done a project recently looking into animals and how to manage animal preparedness for natural hazards. Could you tell us a little bit about that project?
Yeah, sure. So I've been working in this area for about 5 or 6 years now. I had funding from the Bushfire Natural Hazards Cooperative Research Centre. And as part of that project, I've done quite a lot of small sort of projects within that big programme. So I've looked at best practice overseas, looked at what we're doing here in Australia in different parts of the country, and has spent, I guess, some of the fun things I've done have really been working more with community, looking at, you know, some of the issues that people have had in previous fires and floods with animals in particular, but also, just trying to find better ways to engage with people and improve the outcomes for people and their animals together.
Now, people are perhaps not familiar, but are there examples of situations where people have put themselves in harm's way trying to look after animals during natural disasters?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think pretty much with every large event we have, there are stories that come out, you know, inevitably. And frustratingly for me as a researcher, they tend to be the one-off sort of anecdotes, which are great examples. But, you know, as a researcher, I'm looking for sort of better, stronger evidence. But to be honest, we always see people who are getting caught out with their animals. We're hearing about people who unfortunately who lose their lives, people who get, you know, in terrible scrapes and need to be rescued with their animals. So it's in every event we have, whether it's a fire or whether it's a flood, we get people unfortunately that do lose their lives because they don't leave their animals behind, and perhaps because they have either been caught out in a way that couldn't have been predicted, or they've stopped and stayed to stay with their animals, and then they've gone into trouble.
I've also heard that a common issue is people going back into emergency areas when emergency evacuations are announced in order to get their animals. Is that a common issue, and perhaps something people don't think about enough?
Yes, again, I mean, we know now in Australia about 62 to 69% with COVID of our households have actually got animals, have got pets, and people see them as part of the family. So if you're not home, and of course, often people aren't home when these things start off, You know, one of the first things people want to go back and do is to get their animals. And of course, that means they're going into danger just at the time when the emergency services are really, you know, asking people to sort of get out of the area and to be safe. So we do see a lot of that. We see people, you know, going around roadblocks to get their larger animals to get home. And it's, you know, it's really very stressful for everybody really concerned.
Now, I guess the question is, Mel, and you've got a psychology background, why haven't people prepared better for emergencies with their animals?
You know, there's a range of issues here. I mean, it's starting off with people who haven't prepared at all for themselves. But we do, you know, even people who've prepared well perhaps haven't considered their animals sufficiently. So sometimes animals are forgotten altogether, in the same way that sometimes children can be as a separate entity, because they're seen as essentially an extension of ourselves. So we don't necessarily always think about the fact we have to do things differently for them. But of course, with animals, you know, they have a range of different needs and different sort of things that are required practically to look after them, and often to transport them. So what we find is that that people may have considered their animals at some level, but haven't really thought through the reality of the situation. You know, maybe they've only got one car at home instead of two. Maybe they've got four horses and one two-horse float. So there are a whole lot of things here that can cause people to come unstuck. And at the end of the day, also, just the amount of time it can take to get your animals packed up, get them in the car and leave, you know, even that can be seriously underestimated in terms of what it takes in an emergency situation.
What are some of the challenges other than that that people face during emergencies looking after their animals?
Yeah, I mean, one thing we talk about here is obviously the importance of having a plan, which obviously makes sense. And as you suggested, you know, time is really not on your side in these emergency situations. So it's not the time you want to be making decisions on the fly. So, you know, that's not the time to make decisions. You want to think ahead of time. We want people to, you know, think about, the behaviour of their animals. So, you know, if you've got one cat or one dog, it might be reasonably straightforward for you to evacuate with that pet. But if you've got multiple dogs or multiple cats or a mix of different animals, having them all together in one car can be quite a big ordeal. It can be very stressful, and it can be quite crazy. So, you know, those things aren't always obvious, and some animals, of course, become very stressed, very upset. We have old animals who we don't want to sort of upset unduly. So there are quite a lot of other considerations in there that perhaps aren't front of mind when we start thinking about what we might do just loosely without sort of really sitting and thinking through it all.
So what should people do if they do want to take that time to sit and think it all through? What should people be thinking about?
Well, the good thing is in this area, there's some great resources out there. You know, across Australia, all the states and territories have got some sort of information. In New South Wales, I've been involved with Get Ready Animals, which has got some great resources out there, looking at really just helping you to sit down and think about what your risks are, thinking about your household broadly, which is not just your human family, but your animal family, thinking about the, you know, in that, some of those pets we don't necessarily think about so much. So we find in the research that chickens are often not considered, but they might be really special to the children, for example. So we've got examples of people getting ready to leave and then the children pipe up, well, what about the chickens? We need to take the chickens. So suddenly the plan has to be extended and expanded. So, you know, thinking about who you're going to take, of course, thinking about where you're going to go. That's really important because you're going to need to ideally go to friends and family, emergency centres, evacuation centres can accommodate animals in certain circumstances, and we want people to be safe. So we do want them to go to evacuation centres, even if they have their animals, even if we need to do something after that. But they're not necessarily what you want to plan for ideally. Really, you want to have somewhere you can go with your animals and take them with you. So we have that sort of side of it. We also think about the practicalities. So, you know, it could be about the logistics. It could be about having extra bowls or plates or those records that are available, so you've got them ready to go in the car with you. And then talking to other people. So one of the key things here that we've seen is really important in some areas where there have been emergencies where people haven't been at home. So, for example, in the Blue Mountains near me, we had fires back in 2013. A lot of people commute, so they weren't home. So there, the importance is to talk to other people about your plan. So if your neighbour knows your plan in your neighbour's home, your neighbour can get your dog, your neighbour can pick up your photographs, you know, everything. If you talk about your plan with other people, you know, there's a chance that they can help you out when you need that help. So that connection as well is really important as part of your planning.
Well, great. Thank you so much, Mel. Hopefully this is a bit of a reminder for all of us to take the initiative and plan for the next emergency, which could be near us. So thank you so much for joining us.
You're welcome. Thanks for talking about this important subject.
Animals rely on us 100% for food, water, and certainly for an emergency situation to get them out of danger. That's vital.
If you've got animals, you need a plan. Certainly you can't rely on them to do what you would expect. If we're going to keep them in the environment that we keep them in, we are 100% responsible for them.
I think that anyone who hasn't made an emergency plan for their family animals, they should really sit down and have a good think about where they want to go, so they're not trying to make those decisions under pressure, and so that it can be done as quickly and effectively as possible without stressing themselves and their animals at the time.
If you need to move multiple animals off the property, you need to do it well ahead of time. If you're not going to move them off the property, you've got to know what you're going to do to try and avoid them getting in trouble.
If you live in a fire zone and you have animals, you have to have a plan to get them out, so please think about it long before it happens. It's essential.
Thanks again for joining us, Mel. Now, we closed there with a video from the Department of Primary Industries, New South Wales, but obviously that information applies for a number of different natural disasters and across state lines. Now, we'll also include a bunch of links to other resources which could be helpful to you in the event of natural disaster and looking after your pets. And while I'm on the topic of links, the Bureau of Meteorology's Autumn Outlook is out today and it's looking a bit wet. So I'll include the link for that too, wherever we're including links. Now, in other weather news, we're also expecting the IPCC's next report on impacts and adaptation to climate change to come out next week. So have a look for that. Now, that's all that we have for On the Radar today. We're still gearing up with this series, so if you do have any information or questions that you'd like to see featured on the show, please do let us know. Now, I'm going to leave you today with a clip from Animals Keeping Cool at the Zoo, which could come in handy for tips for anyone still baking in the West. So until next week, then, please stay out of floodwaters. I'm Kate Doyle, and this has been On the Radar.
Basically, if you're feeling warm as a human, guarantee that most of the animals are feeling warm. When it's warm like this, we do lots of different things to help them cool down, such as putting on sprinklers. They seem to like that. They'll either go into the rain and cool off or stay in the shelter and then enjoy the cool air that the water creates. One of our favourites is giving them ice blocks. So if it's for an otter, we might give them fishy cubes where they have lots of different fish and prawns frozen in them. Or maybe something that's a bit sweet, made out of fruit juice or ribena and things like that for herbivores like chimpanzees who eat a bit of fruit as well. And other things we might do is provide them with air conditioning, such as our wombats who get a balmy 18 degree air conditioned den 24/7, which is pretty cool for them. So there's lots of different things we can do to help them cool off in these warm weather days. Some feel the heat more than others. So chimpanzees, for example, are from a pretty similar climate to here. They're used to the humidity and the warm weather. So they probably cope really well in this sort of temperature. It's what they're used to in the wild. It's what they're built for. Other animals that are found in cooler climates, like the wombats, don't cope as well. So we provide them with those extra precautionary things like the air conditioning. Yes.